This one's an interesting one. Mums with violent partners could be unfairly jailed under new laws which make a failure to report child sex abuse to police illegal in Victoria. The warning comes from victim support groups who argue a number of women might be too afraid for their own safety to turn in their abusive partners. The new law follows recommendations handed down after Victoria's inquiry into child sex abuse and carries a 3-year jail term. Joe, it seems these women are between a rock and a hard place.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's obviously you can't help but feel a huge amount of sympathy for anyone who's in an abusive relationship, but you cannot say... Firstly, women have to be empowered one way or another by themselves or by others to not be in abusive relationships in the first place. You have to get out. You absolutely have to get out. And yes, there are huge economic costs often associated with that. Yes, there are often other things, but anything is better than staying in an abusive relationship. And certainly you often see it's only when that sort of Rubicon is crossed and an abusive partner turns on the kids that many women do stand up and leave. But frankly, to say that, you know, you're going to not report a case of child abuse or child sex abuse by your partner because you are scared for your own safety, I'm sorry, it is not an excuse.
Oh, I don't... I think that's a bit harsh because I think, yes, this is all well and good to say this is what you must do, you will face a jail term if you don't. But for many of these women, they're in this terrible vortex of violence and abuse.
Like, sorry, just let
the kids
get
abused? No, but they're not thinking. No, no, but they're not thinking straight. So rather than punishing these women, can't we look at ways to support them? Perhaps there's an option of some groups have suggested that these women could report it anonymously, so they don't feel more at risk that their name isn't put out there. I really think we need to look at ways that we can empower women to get out of those situations rather than blaming them more and more.
Just think how difficult it is. If we think back to that girl, she came from Canada, and the bloke threw her over the balcony, remember? And she died, and here in Sydney it was. And she wrote to her mother that she was scared for her safety. Everyone knew she was scared for her safety, and yet for some reason that girl didn't leave. There were no children involved in this case. There's something.
And she'd seen a counsellor
too. There's something that happens in these relationships. I don't know that it's just abuse. So, I mean, I'm not a psychiatrist, so I don't know all that. But it's almost like they have a control over the person that makes it very difficult. But as I understand this Victorian legislation, if a woman is truly scared about her safety, she won't be sent to jail.
I think the jail thing is just simply a sort of a signal that this is how serious it is, and I suspect for many women and for many families that sort of almost forced first step could probably be the best thing that's ever happened to them, because once you do make contact with the police or authorities, it then will expose you to all the support networks that are available that you don't feel like you have access to when you're isolated in a controlling, abusive relationship.
If you don't earn money, if you have no income of your own, and you're totally dependent on this bloke, it's a very big step for a woman to have to
pay. Yes, but you cannot allow your children to be abused.
I agree with you, Joe, but you've got to put yourself in the... you've got to think of yourself as the woman. You know, it's all very well for us to say, you've got to do this and you've got to do that.
I understand.
But we know how hard it is.
I understand how difficult it is.
And especially if you feel that your partner is going to murder you. And your children.
You don't understand, and I assume none of us understand how hard it is. And when a woman's in this position, you can't go and threaten her with jail. You just can't. You've got to give her the support and the help to let her leave, you know, and the counselling and the networks and the safe houses. But jail's not going to work. She's already scared enough.
We are talking about the kids here.
Well, I've been close to it in a number of different ways, and you can't threaten someone who's already a victim of awful circumstances with jail without giving them adequate support. And it's not there because everything is stretched, and you know we see women die every single week.
Joe is right. Once the abuser goes to the children, it's usually the catalyst that makes a woman act.
That's right. And I think it would only be in the most unusual circumstances that a jail term would ever be exposed. I think what the purpose of this is obviously to create that first point of contact between an abused woman and the people who can help her.
A bit of a change of
case now. Earlier in the show, we were discussing a new crime in Victoria which could see mums with violent partners unfairly jailed if they fail to report child abuse to police. Victim support groups are worried that some women might be too afraid for their own safety to turn in their abusive partners. Now, our next guest, Rosie Batty, she lost her own son, Luke, in tragic circumstances earlier this year at the hands of her violent ex-husband. And she is outraged by the crime that carries a jail term of up to 3 years. Rosie, good morning to you. Do you think this is placing unfair, I suppose, stress on the wrong person?
I am absolutely outraged. I was living in hope that because of Luke's tragic death, it would bring a huge awareness to family violence. This is beyond my comprehension how, again, the woman who's the victim is punished. And Joe, your comments are so, so misguided. If you minimise how it feels to be feel unsafe, and when we're talking about unsafe, we're talking about the risk to our lives. We're talking about when women finally may decide to leave their partners, they are at their most risk. And you know what happened to me? Greg had finally lost control of me. And to make me suffer, and the final act of control, which was the most hideous form of violence, was to kill my son. So don't you ever think that if we don't report, it's because we don't want to. It's because we are so scared about what might happen.
Rosie, as someone... Rosie, as someone who has been very, very close to domestic violence as a child and also as an adult, to be fair to Joe, unless you've been in it, it's really hard for people to understand.
Joe needs to look at his views as a man and he needs to step up and get informed. Because when I hear comments like that, I am so saddened that the focus is still on the woman. Where the hell is the perpetrator? Why isn't he being jailed for 3 years?
I think, Rosie, I don't want to interrupt you, but so let me know if you want to keep going. But my understanding, the law's
actually... Absolutely, I want to keep going.
Okay, sure.
Rosie, how do you think, given the laws that have been changed, come in Victoria, you clearly don't agree with it. So how do you think your state and Australia generally should treat people in your situation? What is it?
The focus needs to be on the perpetrator, not the woman. I went to child protection. I did everything I was supposed to do. But no one can protect me 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And I was under the impression from the police commissioner and various other people that have been in contact with me, we're looking at real progressive change. But this kind of act is just beyond my comprehension right now. Think that what I've been through for 12 years and then I could actually face a prison term for 3 years, it's just... I don't know. I don't understand.
I think, Rosie, my understanding of the laws that are being proposed in Victoria is that, firstly, that they do actually provide a protection for people who believe that they are in direct danger if they do report abuse.
And so, Joe, where do you go to get protected 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, Joe?
Yeah, but the laws are saying you would be exempted, so it would not be a crime if you didn't report child abuse or child sex abuse if you were feared for your own safety for doing so. My understanding is that that is in the legislation. The purpose of this is to make sure that the perpetrator is caught and to make sure that the children are protected,
yes,
and that is of paramount importance without putting the onus on people who might also suffer. That's very clear. I know that some groups have said that it's possible in a scenario that a jury or a judge might not accept this. But the laws themselves are not...
Why would the woman have to face that? It's not that they're doing it deliberately because they don't care or they're ignorant. You really need to keep looking at why do we focus on women and punish them constantly? The focus I don't understand. I don't,
the intention of the law is not to punish women, Rosie. The intention of the law is to make the protection of the child the absolute priority and to prevent that child from being exposed to sex abuse or further sex abuse or further abuse, right? So that is the intention of the law. And sometimes I think it can be a circuit breaker, if you like, where there is mandatory reporting. We've seen in other fields mandatory reporting be imposed, and that has been a good thing and a bad thing. Sometimes it's overloaded caseworkers, but certainly in this case, the idea is that, and this is in response often to institutional child abuse and child sex abuse. So it's to make workers in places like the Catholic Church or the Salvation Army, where we've heard tales of horrendous abuse, to make it an offence for people to stay silent about that. There is an exemption for envisaging the domestic violence situations for people who fear that their own safety would be endangered for doing that. I know that some groups have said that maybe that won't work or maybe that's not enough, but that is the intention of the law is not to punish the mother.
I think what Aunt Rosie is so upset about is that the law is being used to scare women into doing the right thing rather than putting more support systems and support networks in place, which then empowers her to do the right thing. Am I right in that kind of train of thinking?
Yeah, I just think it's years ago, and I don't know how, women were taken away from their mothers because they couldn't keep them safe. The focus has always been on the mother and punishing them.
Rosie, in terms of, you mentioned their mothers, how are you going? I mean, you indeed are such a remarkable woman, and I think you're inspiring so many people across the country about, dignity and grace in the face of unbelievable tragedy. How are you doing? And we're giving you the most massive hug, Rosie. I think you're so brave, and thank you for talking about something that really needs to be talked about. Are you okay to talk about your fundraising?
Yes, I am. And I guess from my perspective, when I was sat here earlier, I really, really didn't like the way the panel spoke about that situation. And I still feel there's so much education to go for men and women about what I'm now experiencing. But my fundraising, we had a wonderful cricket day on Sunday. And it was a really special day, and people's understanding and comfort have made a huge difference to me.
And I think, Rosie, thank you for sharing some of your story, because what you are doing is helping so many other families across the country, and it's meaning we are having discussions like the very discussion that we are having today. So thank you for doing that.
Rosie, can I just say, I completely agree with you. I think you're remarkable. You're an amazing, inspiring woman. I would be interested to hear, when you said earlier that the police commissioner had, you were hoping that he'd come to some more progressive measures, what were you hoping he would do? What should he do?
He's already changed the procedure for the issuing of warrants. So in my situation, after leaving the magistrate's court, Greg had a warrant for his arrest. That whole process would take over 2 weeks before it arrived at the police station. So in that 2 weeks, no one at the police station knew there was a warrant out for his arrest, which is how come Greg was out that day. So he's changed that to now like a day or 2 days. So that's a huge leap. I understand that they're also looking at the intervention orders, and they've identified a number of repeat offenders that break intervention orders constantly and terrorise families. And they've identified 130 families in grave risk. And so it's basically they're looking at this is an intervention order is a piece of paper. It doesn't enforce them to obey it. And that's what they're looking at as well.
Well, Rosie, from all of us here on the panel, and I think Jess put it so beautifully before, it's because of your story that this is back on the national agenda and people are actually talking about it, because for such a long time it has been swept under the rug, and your bravery has just been incredible to watch.
So thank you. Lots of love, Rosie. Thank you, and I appreciate you letting me have the opportunity to talk.
Not at all.
Is a passionate subject, and I want... It's good, like you say, we all need to learn something from it, and I keep learning as well, so let's keep learning.
Yeah, you are welcome on our show anytime, Rosie. Thank you very much. And if you'd like to find out more about the Luke Batty Foundation, it's a great cause, visit gofundme.com/LukeBattyFund.